now lives in New Orleans and actually divides his time between the Crescent City and Venice, Italy. He is by profession a painter, but also a musician, and he spends his time doing one or the other.
Party?
That's right.
Recording studio.
Okay, when are we going on?
Any second now. Shall I can open with a recording.
Okay.
Which one?
We'll make sure Paul's on it.
But I was walking in the door from a gig I had in Baltimore. 3:30, and they were just getting in there. Coming out of walk, and there they were in the hall, you know. No, they live in Springfield. They used to live in Springfield.
What'd you say? I can't hear you. The door's closed.
Tony Gill on Jazz 90 with Someone to Light Up My Life. This is from the brand new compact disc, Essentially Joe Beam. And this should hit store shelves this week. That's the release parties this week. Maybe it's on store shelves now. We're going to find out. Tony Gill is here with us, and joining him is Paul Bollenback. Gentlemen, good afternoon.
Hey, Tim. How you doing?
I'm great. How about yourself?
Good. Good. Everything's good.
Hi, Tim. How you doing?
I'm great. I want to make sure, because we got so many mics hooked up in there.
This is true.
Paul, say something.
Check.
Okay, we got you hooked
That's
up
good.
There. Tony?
Top of the morning to you.
All right, we got our St. Patrick's Day thing going. Well, first off, let's see, where do we begin? Tony, a great article on the weekend section on Friday.
Oh, thank you very much, but contrary to all rumors, I'm not quitting music. I'm just stopping recording CDs for a while.
You're anticipating my question.
Yes.
I was going to say, you're killing me over here, because, you know, the CD comes out, and then it says it's the last one. What's that all about?
Well, I had told him that it was the last one for a while, and I guess the spin on it that they put was that I was quitting the business. But that's not the case.
Okay, so did you have, like, a set goal in mind when you started recording? I mean, the article made mention of the fact that you've recorded a lot of discs in the last couple of years, in a very short period of time. And was the Joe Beam project always there for you?
No, not necessarily. I mean, Brazilian music has always been an influence in anything that I've done. Mm-hmm. So in the background, Joe Beam was there, and I've done some Joe Beam tunes in the records before. But the main impetus was Charlie Berg and the opportunity to record with him some Joe Beam tune. And the untimely death of Joe Beam, obviously. Mm-hmm. I started me thinking along that. I had the musicians that would definitely be able to interpret that kind of music the way I wanted it to be interpreted, and that's how it fell into place.
And when you deal with a composer like Joe Beam, who has not only a lot of compositions that he's written, do you know how many off the top of your head?
No, I don't.
But a lot of songbooks as well.
You're not going to tell me?
No, I don't know. I can't count that.
Paul, do you know how many?
Probably hundreds.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah.
And those are probably just the ones we know about.
Right.
The treasure trove of undiscovered children.
That's right. The trunk in the attic.
Right. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
The dark years.
Right.
Joe Beam's blue period.
Oh, there you go.
Green period.
Thank you.
Shouldn't be going.
When you're dealing with that repertoire, and you've got songbooks out there, Ellen Fitzgerald's done a songbook, and especially after he passed passed away, there were collections coming out. How do you select the tunes you're going to record?
Well, the main thing that I wanted to avoid was some of the songs of Jovim's that are over-recorded. Not that they're, you know, any less beautiful, because all of his songs are beautiful, but there's some that in this country in particular have become almost to the point where they become lounge songs. Overplayed. I don't know if they're over-recorded, but certainly overplayed. And I wanted to, I knew that there were so many other songs that he wrote that were so beautiful that I knew. I was surprised that a lot of people didn't know them, and that's what I wanted to record. Songs like Bonita, Ele Carioca, Ana Luisa, Vivo Soñando, that you just don't hear all the time.
When you're recording Jobim material, and you say you wanted to sort of avoid some of the more recorded works, do you feel like there's a responsibility or an artistic necessity to include some of those tunes, just because some of the lesser known ones are the ones that aren't heard as much?
No, not necessarily. Again, I thought that if you did an album that was just the songs you always hear, like Corcovado, Meditation, Girl from Ipanema, Wave, that might, in a sense, detract the listener or the people that buy the music, because they've heard it before, and all they're doing is just listening to a different version. Certain musicians have that appeal, that if somebody will go and buy a new record, regardless of what they record, even if the music's been, you know, overdone. But in this particular case, like I said, I wanted to make sure that I recorded songs that you don't hear all the time. And with the type of musicians that I had, that I knew they could play that kind of music, you know, very well, I wanted to include just those songs and try to avoid some of the other ones, even though I did, as you notice, I did a medley at the end with some of his more popular tunes, but I wanted the musicians to play them rather than for me to sing them. And so you can hear them instrumentally as well.
And we should mention that among these several discs that have come out under your name, late last year, there were two that sort of came out on the heels of each other. One, the tribute to Felix Grant, Tenderly, and the other one, Dio Teatro Cuento, which is a Spanish language disc. When you, and of course, highly acclaimed, Whammy award-winning and things like that. When you set out to record Jobim, is there a decision there that has to be made? Obviously there is, but can you tell me about it? Whether you're going to record in English or Portuguese?
Oh, I don't think I ever had any doubt in my mind that it was going to be English. Not all of Jobim's lyrics have been translated into the English language. As you know, there's several versions of some of his songs. There's several versions, beginning and endings, mostly endings of Corcovado, for example, Quiet Nights, Quiet Stars. A lot of people took their hand at writing the lyrics of that. I wanted to, do them in English. It was an English album. But I wanted to record some of the songs in Portuguese, a couple of them. And, forgive my Portuguese, it's not very good, even though I speak Spanish. I didn't have much training in it. There was one particular song on the album that I couldn't find English lyrics. Maybe they are. Felicidade, I believe, and so I wrote some English lyrics for that. But the primary focus was English.
When you write English lyrics, do you have to get special permission from the state or anything?
No. If the lyrics haven't been written before, then you don't have to.
Let's see. I was going to ask you something about
Paul Bollenback?
About Paul Bollenback. I forgot about Paul.
I'll tell you, man, I'm having a nice, you know, relaxing, listening to the conversation here. It's cool. It's nice.
We're going to enroll you in the conversation.
Oh, okay. How much?
oh, quite a bit. while we're at it, let's talk to Paul.
Oh, no. That's all right.
No, I'm kidding. What is it about the music, Paul, that, as a guitarist, what is it about Brazilian music? Charlie Bird, obviously, we heard on that last.
Mm-hmm.
There's something that
Well, I think so many of the Brazilian composers are guitar players, and the guitar being a very portable kind of an instrument, especially the nylon string guitar, you know, you don't need an amplifier or anything for it. It's something that is used in folk music in various parts of the world, and of course, a certain there's a certain element of that in Brazilian music. The harmony is very sophisticated, but I think the root of it is really just a sort of a very simple boom, ding, boom, ding, gong, ding kind of a thing. And they, of course, they've expounded on that in numerous different ways. So I don't know, aside from the fact that just historically, you know, there's been tons of great Brazilian guitar players, and it seems like most of them, either Jobim was a guitar player. I'm trying to think whether Yvonne Lenz plays guitar or not. I don't really know.
I don't know.
Maybe somebody out there knows, but I mean, the music certainly has that type of a flavor, and when you don't have the guitar in it, I don't know, somehow it misses something, because it's also a rhythm instrument as well as a harmonic instrument.
Musically speaking, what is it about Brazilian music that, where are the roots, you know, where does it come from?
And that's you know, I wish I was the expert on that. I mean, my understanding of Brazilian music is that it's kind of a combination of traditional European music coming from Portugal and from Africa, you know, and then you've got, I guess, like a native Indian influence in there somewhere. I guess it depends on what sort of style you're talking about, because, you know, when we Americans say Brazilian music, I guess a lot of times we're thinking about the bossa nova and the samba, but, you know, I know from being around some guys who are really into Brazilian music that there's, you know, tons of varieties. It's like if you talk to somebody who's really into Cuban music, they talk about all these different flavors of the thing, and a bass player does one thing and it changes the way the conga plays, and it's the same thing with Brazilian music. I'm sure in my somewhat limited, you know, exposure to it.
Well, when you play it, obviously it requires a slightly different approach than if you're playing something else.
Absolutely, yeah. Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, the influences that I kind of try to draw on when I get pushed into a situation, pushed, I shouldn't say pushed, Tony, man, you pushed me into this situation. No, that's not true, because I really love this music. It's great, you know, it has something very warm about it that I like. But, you know, the influences that I think about, of course, Jobim, and I think about guitar players like Egberto Gismonti, and I think about vocalists like Já Gilberto and Gilberto Gil. And I think about Milton Nascimento. Having listened to a number of recordings pretty extensively by these guys and trying to figure out like what the vibe is on it, it really helps. Because if you just had to go in and play it cold, there are certain little things that go on. And I learned some of this stuff from Charlie Bird, actually, by virtue of an interview I did with him one time. You know, we were talking, I asked him, I said, well, what's the authentic, what's the real deal? You were there when Bossa Nova was happening, you know, what is it? And, you know, he explained some of the sort of subtle differences between, like, what the bass would do and what the guitar player does in Brazil versus what an American interpretation of the same thing would be.
Is there anything that you have to do differently in terms of, you know, the way you position your fingers or the way your fingers move across the strings? Or, guess, the type of...
Yeah, that's more it than anything else. Although, I tell you, I've been playing nylon string guitar more and more lately. I just really like the sound of it. And I always have. It was my first instrument, you know, when I was very young. And it's kind of another color with what I do, you know, in my own music. But, yeah, I basically just use a nylon string when I'm doing this stuff with Tony or in other situations that require more Brazilian flavor.
I have to say that this is the first album, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, Paul, that you've used exclusively the nylon guitar.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
And American guitarists usually play single string melody. They're used to playing in a trio jazz guitar. You know, the Brazilian and the Latin players use all their fingers to play melody on the chords. And Paul is a fantastic chord player.